Welcome. I'm Dr. Caroline Heldman, the Executive Director of the Representation Project. We are a nonprofit organization that was founded by our friend Jennifer Siebel Newsom that uses films and campaigns to challenge harmful gender norms and stereotypes. And I am so happy today to be announcing the launch of our Boys Will Be Boys Healthy Masculinities campaign. The purpose of this campaign is to expose how traditional forms of masculinity restrict men and boys, and to really create a space where they can reach their full human potential. Boys will be boys means that they can be anything and everything they want to be without the constraints of restrictive masculinity. So tune in every Thursday, same time, same place, for a stimulating conversation with the world's leading experts on the subject. This is our love letter to boys and men. In case you were wondering, this is about affirming and lifting men and boys up. And I'm so honored to kick off this series with the incomparable Ted Bunch from A Call to Men. I promise I would call him Mr. Bunch a few times, and then we'll do Ted. I will interview Mr. Bunch for a bit and then open it up to your questions. You can submit questions in the Q&A at any point in time. But first, let me tell you about Ted. And give me a minute, because this is a ridiculous bio, and you need to know all of this information to know the level of expertise that Mr. Bunch possesses and why everything he says is going to be gold and valuable today. He is an author, educator, activist, and lecturer who's working to end all forms of violence and discrimination against women and girls. Ted is the chief development officer of a great organization called A Call to Men, which we will learn more about today. And he is internationally recognized for his efforts to prevent violence against women while promoting a healthy respect for manhood. He is a leading voice on male socialization, the intersectionality of masculinity and violence against women, and healthy, respectful manhood. Ted is the co-author of the Book of Dares, 100 Inspiring Creative Fun Challenges for Boys, based on the work of A Call to Men. The Book of Dares has been called, quote, a direct answer to parents' cries for building healthy masculinity, respect, and emotional literacy in their sons. And we'll be asking him about that today. Ted is an adjunct professor at John Jay College of Criminal Justice. He is the former director and co-creator of the largest program for domestic violence offenders in the United States. His innovative work in this area laid the groundwork for the prevention strategies now endorsed as best practices in engaging men to end violence against women. Ted developed and implemented model response programs for police, fire departments, emergency medical technicians, paramedics, and other first responders dealing with domestic violence. So his work has had a profound effect throughout the nation. Bunch is an advisor to and a trainer for the National Basketball Association. He's also provided training to the National Football League, the National Hockey League, Major League Soccer, and Major League Baseball. He was invited to help lead the Time's Up Engaging Men effort and is providing ongoing healthy manhood and sexual harassment prevention training in Hollywood. He was a guest presenter for the United Nations Commission on the Status of Women and the United Nations Alliance of Civilization. And his work has been featured in the UK, Israel, Suriname, South Africa, Ghana, the Democratic Republic of Congo, Brazil, and Puerto Rico. He is the co-author of A Call to Men's Live Respect, Coaching Healthy and Respectful Manhood. It's a curriculum that's designed to prevent dating violence, sexual assault, and bullying in school and in sports. He gives talks at colleges and universities across the nation, and his work is used at the high school level as well. Ted is a frequent guest on national television and radio programs like the Today Show and National Public Radio. You may have heard of them. He's also served as a script consultant for the Emmy Award-winning series Law and Order Special Victims Unit, and for the Tony-nominated Broadway musical Jagged Little Pill. Welcome, Ted Bunch.
Thank you so much, Caroline. I appreciate that. Thank you so much. Glad to be here.
It is just a joy to speak with you. And your bio is ridiculously impressive, my friend. But let's jump right into it. Tell us about your personal path to promoting healthy masculinity. How did you choose this career? Maybe this career chose you. What is your personal story?
Thank you so much. A little bit of both, choosing my career and the career choosing me. I grew up in a household. My parents were educators, but also civil rights activists. So I saw a lot around civil rights and race, and we always had conversations around oppression in the household. And what I also noticed, though, when we were at gatherings and when we had things at our house for some of the other, from some of their colleagues, is that I could see, even as a child, the sexism that I would witness in these conversations, meaning that even within looking at the construct of racism and addressing racism through the civil rights workers who I had privy to, there was sexism within them. In other words, men were the lead, women were there to support, and that was, you know, part of the culture. And it always really concerned me. It always bothered me. I never quite got that. And it always stuck with me. And then I was raised, my father and mother divorced when I was about 6 or 7, and I was raised by my mother and my grandmother, who were really very capable, very smart, very hardworking women. So I grew up in a household where women did everything. So I had this perspective of real respect and love for women and admiration for women. And at the same time, as I'm growing up, really had a lens not only around race, but around gender, around male dominance and what that looked like, how that played out. And in my 20s or so, I started working in the field of chemical dependency treatment, addictions, working as a clinician, and specifically around chronic relapsing men who just couldn't get enter recovery and stay in recovery, or couldn't get sober and stay in sobriety, and started to really peel back the layers of what that was about, the trauma men experienced, the inability to ask for help, the pain that wasn't being expressed, and how they were self-medicating. And that work got some notoriety, and I was asked to do some work with a domestic violence program in New York City, and around working with men. And from that, Caroline, I was offered the position of running this domestic violence program in New York City, and I built it to the largest program in the country. That was with domestic violence offenders. We called them back in the day batterers intervention programs. So it was the largest batterers intervention program in the country, 600 men a week, 26-week program, 20 programs in English, 10 in Spanish. And you know, it didn't do anything to stop domestic violence in New York City. So at the same time, I met and did some work with Tony Porter, who's the co-founder of A Call to Men, along with myself. We founded the organization 22 years ago, but we've been working together probably 27 years. And we were doing work around the country with women who were in the violence against women movement. Tony and I were doing work with some of the leaders in New York State in particular, around addressing the issue of batterers intervention programs and so forth. It's really like, okay, they have their place, but don't see them as the solution. Let's try to end violence against women without batterers programs. How would we do that? What would that look like? So at that point, Tony really came to me with this vision of A Call to Men, that while most violence against women is men's violence, most men aren't violent, but we're silent about those that are. So, and that silence is as much of the problem as the violence and abuse is. So let's speak to the silence. Let's speak to those men who are, you know, living the right way, or think they are, and doing the right thing in their lives. And that's when we started to really look, going upstream to prevention to stop these things from happening in the first place, was the work and mission of A Call to Men. And so that's how, that's kind of where I've come from. You know, it kind of found me, but I was open to it. And, you know, we've been doing it for the last 22 years as A Call to Men. And our vision is to create a world where all men and boys are loving and respectful, and all women, girls, and those in the margins of the margins are valued and safe.
Of course, we love your mission, longtime fans of your work, and, you know, boosting your work whenever possible because of its effectiveness, right? And you're talking about getting at the root, getting at the core of this. Talk to us more about what you're up against. Talk to us about traditional norms of masculinity, restrictive masculinity, yeah, maybe how you define that and what some of those challenges and harms are.
Yeah, well, so when we look at masculinity, when we look at manhood, where in any male-dominated society, whether it's in the U.S. or anywhere else around the world, that's a patriarchal male-dominated society, we really see the same things here. So, which is that, and let me also say, you know, before I kind of start unpacking this, that this is not an indictment on manhood. It's an invitation to men That's really important. And it's not about calling men out, though we need to hold ourselves accountable and hold men accountable. But that's not the goal about calling men out. It's about calling men in, that we're all swimming in the same water, right? That, you know, we benefit as men, as good and well-meaning men as we may be, we still benefit from the construct of sexism, of male dominance that we've inherited, that's just been given to us. We still benefit from that, male privilege and entitlements, all of those things. And then we wound up passing those things down to our boys. So with the work of A Call to Men, we really like to look at the collective socialization of manhood, the collective socialization of men. And even in those batterers programs early on that I was running, one of the reasons why we knew we needed to do something different was because those men in those programs were taught the same thing I was taught, believed very similar things that I believed. I didn't act out in the same way, but I understood what they were thinking and where that was coming from. So it was really about all of us. It's really about us all swimming in the same water, as I mentioned. So that collective socialization, we coined a term years ago, prior to starting A Call to Men, called the man box. And in the man box, and you can imagine all the characteristics in the man box is be powerful, be dominating, no pain, be tough, don't ask for help, don't act like a woman, don't be too caring, be aggressive, be in charge, know the answer to everything. All of these things in the man box, be tough, dominant, acquire things, have money, be athletic, all of those things that are in this man box. And there's lots of wonderful things in the man box, but anything taken to an extreme becomes error. And there's so much more that we are that we don't allow ourselves to be because of the constraints of the man box. The glue that keeps that man box together is homophobia and heterosexism, right? That's kind of how it keeps this construct, because if you're in our society, women are seen as showing their emotions, needing help, all of those things. Men are taught that you're not supposed to show your emotions, except for anger. You're not supposed to need help. You're not supposed to ask for help. And we pass those things down to our boys. And there's a direct line between these rigid notions of manhood that are harming women, girls, and the queer folks are also harming men and boys, right? Our mental health concerns are really, I mean, it's really a crisis for men right now. Suicide, death by suicide is about 4 times higher than that of women. Men live about 5 or 6 years less than women, you know, because of all these issues around not asking for help, high risk behavior to prove that we're men, right? So we enter in some high risk behavior. You know, I have one of my sons is driving now, and he's paying for his own car insurance. And he says, "Why is my insurance so high?" He's under 25. I said, "Well, it's under 25, but also the cost for a 24-year-old male insurance is different than the cost for a 24-year-old female, because there's more accidents, there's more speeding, all these things, because there's this aggression that we start kind of embedding in the socialization early on. So these are the things that are really interfering with men not only being our full authentic selves, because it stops us from being our full authentic self, but also being fully in touch with our humanity. And these are the things that we kind of want to expose, unpack, love men through it, and also build them up through it.
Beautiful. So you made a comment that heteronormativity and homophobia are the glue that kind of keeps this man box construct together. Can you talk to us more about how men use that to police, how that's the glue that holds it together?
Sure. So I'll give you an example of, So in this man box, there's all those things I mentioned, but there's also 3 main tenets that are really part of this man box, that women and girls are seen as having less value than men and boys, right? That's within, let me just let your audience answer this question so that we understand what socialization really means, right? I'm in New York, you're in California. Wherever we are in Main Street, USA, it's a beautiful spring day. There's a 6-year-old boy throwing a baseball with his uncle, his big brother, his father, his maybe youth baseball coach, his little league Pee Wee baseball coach. And that dad or uncle or coach says to him, "Son, you got to throw harder now. You're throwing like a right? Everyone knows the answer to that. Now, it doesn't mean, first of all, girls throw just fine, but we know the answer. And we've never talked about this, Caroline, but we know the answer. So our socialization is that, right? So we're taught. So does that six-year-old boy leave that interaction thinking girls are equal to him or less than him? Well, less than him. How can he not? And we're giving him these messages all day long, even though that dad, uncle, coach, big brother was not intending to harm girls. But we're on this remote control around, again, motivating our boys at the expense of girls. And we do the same thing with men at the expense of women. We do the same thing. I remember when I was, my oldest son was 10 years old or so, and I would go out to do this work. He's 25 now. Go out to do this work, Caroline. And I'd kiss everybody goodbye, and he'd walk me out to the car, pulling my laptop bag behind him, and I would lean down to him. And this is a dad and son moment. He's my oldest son, 10 years old. This is a dad and son moment. Leaning down to him. I'm actually looking forward to this time with him because it's like a bonding moment. And I lean down to him like any good dad who's leaving town to his oldest son, whether he's 10 or 5, and said, okay, son, now you take care of things around here. You're the man of the house. Take care of your mother. All of these things, right? Now, I'm teaching him wonderful things in that moment. I'm teaching him to be a protector, to be accountable, to be responsible. Those are great lessons. But it occurred to me in that time, and I've done this 50 times before, it occurred to me in that moment, though, that, wait a minute, take care of things around here. You're the man in the house, all these things. I'm teaching him those responsibilities, those to be accountable and to be a protector and all of those things at the expense of his mother, right? Because he says, I said, you got a son? Yeah, I got a dad. Well, he doesn't have anything, Caroline. What does he have, right? He has nothing. He has nothing at 10 years old. So, but I'm motivating him at the expense of his mother in the same way that we motivate that boy at the expense of girls. So we do these things all the time. And this is not an indictment on fatherhood, right? But this is just the way it's kind of embedded in our socialization. So less value is something that's in our collective socialization. Seeing women as property of men is another. So that if I'm in, again, your state or any state in the U.S., and even in 2024 today, all that we know about domestic violence, if I see a man hitting his wife or girlfriend, I walk over to him and I say, knock it off, he's going to tell me to mind my business, right? And then the other thing is that we're taught to sexually objectify women. So back to the point around the man box and how we police each other is I want to give you two examples, one around objectification and then one around how we police each other. Let's look at the 16-year-old boy in your community, in my community, or in any community of your listener. Great kid, high school junior. He just asked a young woman who's also a high school junior to go out to a movie. His name's Kevin. Her name is Kathy. And he gets on a group text with a couple of his buddies and says, hey, I'm taking Kathy out to the movie. We're going to go to the movie. I'll hit you guys up later, right? So they give him a little crap for that, but, you know, they're just having some fun with him. He takes Kathy to the movie, drops her off at home, actually. He's the perfect gentleman. Gets back on the group text with his buddies and says, hey, I'm back from the movie. Is the first thing those boys ask him is, how was the movie?
Huh?
Yeah, no, they don't. They ask him, did she put out? What'd you get? All these other things, right? Because from their mind, 16 years old now, so that because they didn't come up with this on their own, we passed it down to them. In their mind, they're like, well, if you spend the time with Kathy, it must be about having sex with her. It must be about something. So if Kevin says, I wasn't trying to do anything with her, I want to see if she wants to hang out and be my friend, just like you're my friend. In that moment, they'll have some things to say to him about that as well. Mm-hmm. They'll say, what's wrong with you? You don't like girls? Are you this? You that? Everything comes into question now. So now, because they're now saying things to him to punish him, to police him, because they're letting him know that he's not living up to the expectation of manhood that the generation above them has passed down to these boys. So it's all embedded in our socialization, not in our DNA, though. This is really important. that these behaviors, attitudes are not embedded in our DNA. It's embedded in our socialization, but it's embedded in our socialization from a very young age.
Absolutely. Thank you. I love your examples, bring it to life, right? Because these are, I think, for a very long time, kind of dusty academic concepts. And you're bringing them to life through obviously, right, in a way that's super accessible. And I think that's been a big shift in the last couple of years, right, that we're talking more about this, and we're talking more about this to the in ways that in to folks who need to can be helped by this. So just to complicate things a bit, because your work is very complex, right, you're engaging the intersections of race and gender and other intersections. I'm hoping you can talk to us about how the pressures of restrictive masculinity affect different marginalized men differently.
Yes.
Right?
Yeah. Yeah. And let me also say how it affects women, marginalized women as well, right? Because in our vision statement that I shared earlier, that we work to create a world where all men and boys are loving and respectful, and all women, girls, and those in the margins of the margins are valued and safe. We started using that word "all" about 12 years ago, because instead of saying violence against women, we added all women. Because when we say violence against women, we tend to think center, not the margins, right? So even if we Google statistics, that's kind of like when we look at domestic violence or sexual assault, you're looking at statistics of the general population. But when we say all, then we have to think about, oh, yes, even the Native women in Minnesota, and yes, even the Hmong women in the Midwest, and yes, even financially poor white women, and yes, Black women, women of color, those women who we don't think about, we don't think about initially. So that's where the word all is important. And if we're going to end violence against all women, then we have to be willing to work with the men and boys that they love. So that means all men. So that's where the work of A Call to Men is. We're kind of go everywhere. We're in the process now of putting together some programming for rural white males in particular around gun violence. We're in the process of doing that, right? Because they clearly need support. And we're talking about all men, all women. So with men of color and the man box, that masculinity, how that gets played out is just like all other men, really. It's really around patriarchy and male dominance. The difference is that, let's say Black men, for example, because you might look at, I often hear with music videos how hyper-masculine it is, all of these things, where when we look at Black men and masculinity and how it shows up, Black men, unlike white men, get to express it in a patriarchal society in the United States where there's a construct of a white race being seen as the preferred race and male being perceived as the preferred gender. So they get to play out power, dominance, control in many different ways, in business, in louder and bigger, and it might be in a music video, it might be in violence in the community, and so forth. But what's important here is that this male dominance is not helping anyone. It's not benefiting those Black men. It's not benefiting the Black women. It's not benefiting women of color, for the men of color. It's not benefiting white women when white men exercise it. And there's so much trauma, though, with men of color in just being in a white-dominated, white supremacist society, men of color experiencing trauma in different ways just by being in the skin that they're in. They're experiencing trauma in different ways. So it shows up in different ways. And at the same time, we're not expected to ask for help, because that's seen as weakness too, right? Because it's the man box. So everything's a little bit more exaggerated, I think. Because we're not supposed to ask for help. That's seen even more so as a sign of weakness in the man box. And so mental health is not something that going to therapy is not something that men of color necessarily line up to do. trust or distrust of the medical field as well as the psychiatric field. So there's lots of different nuances, but when we look at male, the socialization of men and the man bots, it really fits all men very similarly, but might, you know, it might, it's colored a little differently as well.
And you're saying men of color, deeper injury, more trauma, and less of an ability to seek help given social pressures.
Yeah, for all those reasons, yes.
I think we have a good sense of the issue and the complexity of the issue and the harms to boys and men and girls and women, all. Let's shift gears here for a moment and talk about your idea of healthy masculinity and what would it look like to live in that world?
Well, so when we talk about healthy masculinity, we're talking about embracing our full range of emotion, right? Having emotional literacy, language for the way that we feel, that we're not just stuffing these feelings. You know, we tell that 6-year-old boy or that 3-year-old boy to stop crying. You know, when we tell him to stop crying, we're also telling him to stop feeling. He doesn't know the difference, and he doesn't develop the language to then express himself. And then it becomes anger, and that's what's allowed to be expressed. And that then gets played out where it might be expressed outwardly or inwardly, right? Because when we talk about, I mentioned death by suicide earlier, but there's also death by despair, overdose, alcoholism, all these things that are really done to self-medicate, but then you wind up having all these consequences as a result of it. So being able to fully express our full range of emotions and allow our boys to do the same, not conforming to the pressure of always being fearless and in control, right? Always being fearless and in control. That's something that men, and you know, one of the things that a call to men that is so impactful, and you've witnessed a little bit of it in our conversation, is storytelling is really important. That's what really touches, that brings us from the mind to the heart. And we really want to touch the hearts of men because that's what's going to make the change. It's not going to be lecturing them or a didactic. It needs to be a transformation. It needs to be engaging them. That's the way to engage them. Hey, sharing this story, and they'll be like, oh, wow, yeah, I identify with that too, right? So being able to not always be in control and to be fearless, and we're conditioned to be in control and to not ask for help in many different ways, including the medical issues, not to ask for help. We wind up going in to the doctor for an intervention instead of preventative medicine. To value a woman's life and treat all people equally and promote the betterment of humanity, to really value a woman's life, see women as valuable, not to use language that denigrates women, girls, or people of the LGBTQ, transgender, nonconforming community, to not use language that's harmful in that way, whether it's you throw like a girl or don't act like this or don't act like that, right? Those are the things that are really harmful. Challenge the harmful messages that we've received about gender. Develop an interest and experience in women and girls outside of a sexual conquest, because like my example with the teenage boys, that's what they think. If you're spending time with a girl, like that's supposed to be the goal. And you know, we want to interrupt that. And then also just to continue to promote healthy masculinity. But authenticity is really the key to healthy masculinity, right? So my masculinity, how I express myself, might be very different than some of the men that might hear this, but that's their masculinity. It's their authentic selves. So that's what we really want to embrace, is your full authentic self, and to not limit ourselves. You know, if I could just give this example, is as far as authenticity. For the first few years of my marriage, I brought flowers home every week or 10 days to my wife. And, you know, she would appreciate it. And you know, if I didn't bring them home, she wasn't really asking where are the flowers, or didn't think that I didn't love her or anything like that. When flowers weren't in the house, Caroline, when they weren't present, I was missing them.
Ah. Yep.
You know, I was the one who missed the color and missed the smell coming in, all those things. So it took me about a year to recognize that, well, she doesn't really care about the flowers. I care about the flowers. It made a difference to me that when I come in the house, it gives me a sense of peace. I love the colors. Now when I go to the florist, knowing this, now when and once I embraced it, instead of trying to hide this desire I had under bringing it for a woman, right? Because my socialization said, real men don't like flowers, So once I, but my authentic self really always wants flowers around. And now when I go to the florist, I pick out the flowers. I'm very intentional about what flowers. They say, do you want it in a vase? No, I don't want it in a vase. I'll take it home because I want to arrange the flowers because I like flowers. So that's like an example. Every man has a story like that, that they didn't do something that they've wanted to do because this man box has held them back.
So
it holds us hostage.
Your flower example, just a quick aside, on your Instagram, McCaldeman's Instagram, there's this video that says, the first time that most men get flowers is their funeral. And it's just a speaking to that point, so impactful. And if I could summarize, what I'm hearing you say, about what this world would look like, it would be men embracing the full range of emotions, giving up this notion of control, and the performance of masculinity through high risk behaviors, and also through the objectification of women. But it all really comes down to authenticity. And I will say, viewers, you are getting a masterclass in how to convey information on a subject that normally causes people to get very defensive. It is a brilliant masterclass. Thank you for that, Ted. Following up on that, so this is the world we want to get to. What advice do you have for parents of boys to get there?
So for parents of boys, is to really allow them to reveal who they are to you, to not confine them to, this is what boys do, this is what girls do, and to really allow them to, like a flower, blossom in front of us, and to expose them to different things. And if they lean into, I don't know, creative arts, theater, for example, if they lean into that, let them go with that. Like, that's really important. We have the Book of Dares that you mentioned earlier. This Book of Dares, we wrote, it's 100 ways for boys to be kind, bold, and brave. And we have these positive challenges. There's 100 positive challenges, and we interviewed boys all around the country. It's for boys between the ages of like 7 and 12, 13. Though we found that older kids really enjoy it, and fathers reading with their sons are really learning a lot about masculinity and authenticity through it. And we interviewed all these boys around these dares, and they were like, yeah, we really like dares because it's like really kind of frightening, but it's also exciting. So we said, well, let's put these into positive challenges. So they're in three different categories. Healthy masculinity is one, authenticity is another, and gender equity is another. So there's about 33 or so of each of the, in those categories of dares. And that's a really good way. And then you can get it on the website, but you can go right to Amazon and have it delivered immediately. And it's the Book of Dares, 100 Ways for Boys to Be Kind, Bold, and Brave by Penguin Books at Random House. And there's just wonderful examples for what boys can do that really allow them to embrace their full range of emotion. One of the dares around healthy masculinity is dare you to name three emotions you experienced today. And then there's a vignette on, about each of the dares so that the boys get to say, oh, I have more than happy and sad. I have more than that. And I can talk about my disappointment. I can talk about these things so that it really gives some normalcy, I should say, to talking about my emotions. There's another one around gender equity. I think it's that comes to mind. Wear your favorite female, dare you to wear your favorite female jerseys to school today. And then there's others around authenticity. You know, if you like football, baseball, or soccer, that's great. If you like to dance, we dare you to dance. You know, those kinds of things. So really allowing our boys to just have their full range of emotion, especially emotion, because what they'll do is just shut it down because that's what they've been taught. Even if we ask them to, even if in our home we don't say shut it down, the messages they're getting in school, the other kids in society is toughen up. Real boys, real men don't do that.
So parents essentially providing this space to with to protect against what the message they're getting from media, from their peers, from certainly like video games, I guess that's a form of media, but from the world that is kind of crushing in on the home. So, and I know a lot of parents, and I frame it that way, because there's a lot of parents who want to do right in their home, and are striving to do that. And then the outside pressure overrides them. There are also parents who are looking at this as, you know, the world is a really brutal place. So sometimes when you step out, they want to minimize the bullying. Can you speak to some of those challenges? Let's say you have a parent who, you know, their boy, I have this very experience. I don't know why I'm saying a parent. When I was raising my nephew, he loved wearing nail polish, and it would often get him physical violence at school. What advice would you give in that situation for navigating that?
Yeah, that's tough. You know, and there is a lot of bullying, and so, again, homophobia and heterosexism, that's all tied in there. And anything that doesn't conform to the binary, and like a boy wearing nail polish, it doesn't conform to the binary, right? That boys do this, girls do this. And so I would encourage, you know, we want kids to be safe, right? So we don't want them to be harmed. But we also want to really, support them being who they are, and to be able to educate them around that. It's clearly not you. Your nephew, for instance, isn't the problem. It's those other kids that are the problem. And to really be able to talk about that, to process that with them. And also, you know, I have to say, because I have, and if anyone goes to my IG or even at A Call to Men, we posted some things around my youngest child and myself, Jalen, who identifies as queer, and whose pronouns are they, them, and I've written a number of articles about my own process in their coming out, and then later on in their changing their pronouns, and really educating myself about their experience, not only through them, but also in my own way through other people who I know who are gay, for example, to get more information about how to be the best parent to him. But to really not, I never wanted to have them decrease who they are, right? To really allow them to continue to increase who they are, but also needing them to be protected. So just finding out ways to protect. I mean, we were gonna go somewhere, we were gonna travel out of the country, and to a country that's very homophobic and very heterosexist, and he didn't feel comfortable. He's like, they knew that they couldn't fully express who they are, and we were like, well, we're not gonna go there. Then you know what? Let's find someplace else to go. So you want to do things that can protect your kids, but I would also want to educate the school. I would want to go to the school and say, hey, what can you do around educating these kids around diversity that's within these walls? I think that's something very important too.
Thank you. Empathy, education, authenticity. One last substantive question before we hop into the Q&A, which would be, and we'll ask about A Call to Men in a bit, but where they can find you. What advice would you give to your younger self? What do you wish you knew about masculinity, or what was in front of you when you were young?
Wow, that's a very interesting question, Caroline. I think that what I would want to share with my younger self is to not be afraid. You know, there was a lot of fear about what being a man is, what being a man should be, and a lot of fear about falling short. And that now I know that it really is really around, as I mentioned earlier, reimagining what masculinity can be for you. Even, I mean, it's not unusual for us to call it masculinities, plural, because how I show up as a man, how someone else shows up as a man might be very different. And I'm not going to judge that. So I think to really not have fear around that, and not to have believed all the things that I was socialized to believe, you know, I mean, I grew up with James Bond and the Gunsmoke. I mean, a lot of violence, a lot of objectification of women. You know, the Honeymooners, where, you know, he was saying to the moon, Alice, and all those things, which was promoting violence, all of these things, you know. So I think that it would really be around not being afraid to just be my full authentic self.
Wonderful. Where can we find out more about A Call to Men?
Great, thank you. So on social media, we are at A Call to Men, and that's all the social media channels. Our website is acalltomen.org. I'm on Instagram at ted.bunch, and you'll see a lot of A Call to Men's postings on mine as well. And we do elementary schools with our book. We do middle school and high school with we have a curriculum that you mentioned earlier, Live Respect, Life Skills and Well-Being for Boys and Young Men, which is the 12-lesson curriculum. We're in about 60 programs around the country right now in probably 15 states. One of the curriculum, let me just give a quick example of the effectiveness of the curriculum and of prevention. One of the lessons of the curriculum is around sexual assault and consent, right? So we do pre and post surveys. And when we were writing the curriculum, which was written with Scholastic, by the way, when we're writing the curriculum, we asked boys all the in different topics what we should be talking about. So that's how we formulated the curriculum. And their lessons are on authenticity, healthy masculinity, gender equity, privilege, respect for self and others, and healthy relationships. But one of the lessons is around consent. And when we first asked boys to measure how many of them could define consent before the curriculum, only when we went all over the country to all different communities, 19% of boys could define consent, which explains a lot. It explains sexual assault in the military. It explains sexual assault on college campuses. It explains why girls and women between 16 and 24 are at their highest risk for being sexually assaulted. Our boys think no means try harder or get her drunk. At the end of the curriculum, only one lesson is on consent. That number went from 19. After the curriculum, 75% of the boys could define consent.
Yeah.
That's a lot of prevention. So not only were all these victims didn't happen, right? But also all these boys didn't have this terrible thing that they were a part of that now impacts them for the rest of their lives as well. So if we have the conversations with our boys, they get it. And I want to encourage the men on this call to really have those conversations. They need to hear it from us. Our boys need to hear it from us. They need to hear about gender equity from us, respect for women and girls, and not just about their sisters, about all women and girls, and about consent from us. That's really important.
Thank you. Thank you so much, Ted. We're going to jump into some of these great questions. Daryl is asking, you started off by talking about how working with folks, you worked around masculinity and recovery and addiction. They're wondering if what you know now, working about healthy masculinities, has helped understand that space, what lessons you have for working with people in that space today.
Yeah, that's a great question. So I would say that what I've really learned is that alcohol and substance abuse, there's some predisposition that people have, if it's in their family, for example, but there's so much around that men and boys even, and young men, are just self-medicating because they don't have the outlet to talk about what's happening. Instead of that, they bury it, or they drink over it, or they use drugs over it. So they've experienced trauma. Even when we talk about sexual assault, we talk about unwanted sexual experiences as children. It's about 1 in 6 boys have unwanted sexual experiences as children, or have been sodomized, or had or been molested, but don't talk about that. Right. So there's trauma like that. There's trauma of witnessing domestic violence or being victims of domestic violence. There's trauma of just being hurt and disappointed and not having any place to share that, or feeling like I'm not enough because I don't know how to process those things, because these are all the things that the man box teaches our little boys too. So that's, I think, the biggest piece, is that if I was in addictions work or alcohol and substance abuse treatment today, I would really want to go there earlier, probably, with what trauma have you experienced, you know?
Thank you.
What pain are you experiencing? Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Tim asks or comments that change takes courage and patience and compassion for yourself and others. I think that's very much a takeaway of what you presented today. Kat is asking, is a call to men in schools across the US?
Yes. Yes, we are. And if you would like to bring us to your school, you can just reach out to us. I can actually give you my email if that's helpful. Ted@acalltomen.org, ted@acalltomen.org. But if you also go to our website, you can put your email right in there and ask whatever question you have. But yes, we come to schools. We also educate. So we go into schools and work with students on this 12-week curriculum, 12-lesson curriculum. And you can do it in how many weeks you want to do it. But we also, and more of what we do is actually go in and train educators to implement the curriculum. And we find that most helpful because then it can stay within the school. It's not just us coming in and doing this particular group of students and then it's gone. But if you can educate some of your, train some of your educators on the curriculum and then incorporate it into part of your lessons throughout the year, that's really helpful. And even to get some, we also do education just for professionals working with youth, so that they can go in with this understanding analysis and hear things a little differently and understand things a little differently and layer this analysis onto their already great work. We do a lot of work with coaches also. And if anyone's interested, who's a coach out there, on our website, we have a coaching, a virtual coaching event every month that we do with some folks from the NFL. And you can just join us for the conversation.
Wow. Okay. So you can join a conversation, a training with the NFL folks. Anonymous says, thank you, Mr. Bunch. In addition to a call to men and yourself, do you have any thoughts on leaders, activists, authors you would recommend following?
Sure. So I'd recommend, there's a number of folks. I would definitely share with you that Tony Porter, the co-founder of the organization, has a TED Talk that everybody should see.
It's so good.
GQ magazine said it was one of the top 10 TED Talks every man should see. It's got probably about 5 million views at this point. Justin Baldoni, the actor Justin Baldoni, also has a really good TED Talk. We have a resource page on our website that you can go to also that has lots of resources for other programs and other folks doing the work. But the work is building and becoming more and more accessible to folks. It's becoming more normalized. We've had, I think, a lot to do with that because it really is something where we're in a lot of spaces in the military, in schools, professional sports, corporate America. So there's lots of resources on our website for you.
It has much to do with the work that you have done, Ted.
Thank you.
Just incredible. We have a few questions about specifics that folks can do. Would you be able to provide tips on how to address discussing the man box with parents that are locked in it?
Yes. So one of the things that I would really recommend on our website or even our YouTube page, we have some videos that you can actually share. It's like even the TED Talk Tony did was only about 10 minutes, and it's something you can discuss. And just, hey, just share this and let me know what you think, kind of thing, you know? So there's also the book called Breaking Out of the Man Box that you can find on Amazon that's written by Tony. On the YouTube channel, you'll not only see our videos around the man box, but you'll find similar videos that deconstruct masculinity and really promote healthy masculinity from some of the folks who I mentioned earlier. And also we have, again, a lot of things that are online that are free. A lot of our offerings are free online virtual spaces, and you can certainly sign up and share those things. We also have affinity groups for men. We have a call to API men, Asian Pacific Island men. We have a call to warriors, which is for a group of Native men. We have other men's groups as well. So there's lots of things. We also have an online community for moms called A Call to Boy Moms, which is really a cool group of mothers who support each other around raising boys. And that's single moms, married moms, grandmoms. It's pretty cool.
Incredible offerings. Wow. Thank you. Ted, you had mentioned Gunsmoke and the Honeymooners. What do you wish, and this is from Anonymous, what do you wish you saw more of when it comes to how boys and men show up in entertainment media?
Yeah. Yeah, and that also ages me quite a bit. Most of the people aren't going to even know what Gunsmoke or any of those things are, or James Bond without Daniel Craig. So the question was, I'm sorry, Caroline?
What you want to see more of in terms of representations. Yes, yes, and I would just add to that, are there shows that are really good?
Yes. So, well, Ted Lasso, of course, right? That's just the way he is, his spirit, the love, that's like healthy masculinity. That's a wonderful example. I like This Is Us. I think shows are really different. A full breadth of manhood, masculinity. I really think that there's a series on Apple TV. I believe it's on Apple called it's about a basketball player. I'm pulling a blank now. It's about a basketball player out of the Maryland area, DMV area. He's a young black man, and it's just wonderful. I'm not remembering it right now, but it's a great show on Apple about a basketball player. But it really, especially with black men, it really shows a lot of depth of black men and emotion and support and love, which is really something you don't always see. Yes, thank you, Swagger. Thank you very much, Swagger. Swagger is excellent. So Ted Lasso really comes to the surface though for me. So I'd really recommend that.
You know, Bill Rubel, the head writer, we're interviewing him later in this series for precisely that reason, Ted. I mean, that's love my him. Go-to show. And they don't give up all of the great aspects of traditional masculinity, right?
No.
It's still there.
Right, no. And we don't want to. There's so much good that's there. There's so much good that's there. They don't want to give it all up. There's so much good that's there. And that's why I'm saying it's not about indicting men. It's really about inviting men to look at things a little differently. But yeah, that show is really amazing. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. We have a few more minutes. Clara has asked, what about violence toward men and boys? In my opinion or experience, it is inextricably tied to violence against women and girls and gender nonconforming individuals. And do you believe that in order to prevent violence, this means we have to change our understanding of gender from something that is biological to something that is socially constructed?
So I think that men's violence against men, you know, that is the man box that we're taught to be dominant and aggressive with each other as well, right? And then we're supposed to have control and dominate women and children. So all of that's in the man box. And unfortunately, you know, I don't want someone to say, well, you know, I'm the patriarch of my family and I'm not a bad guy and I'm not harming anyone and I'm not controlling anyone. That's not what we're talking about. We're talking about, because being a protector is a good thing, but if it restricts the freedoms of other people, it's not. And women are protectors as well, right? So it's not something that men just own, but aggression and dominance and resolving things with violence is something that we're taught, especially in the United States. You know, we are taught that that's something that's acceptable. You know, there's, you know, even with gun violence, there's, you know, there's something that's part of our culture that's really harmful as it relates to gun violence as well, right? And I'm not saying anything about gun rights or anything like that. I'm not challenging that. I'm just saying that there's something in our culture that's hyper-masculine, solve things with violence, or correct things with violence that you feel like need to be corrected, is part of that socialization, and it's not in our DNA. There was a second part of that question though that I don't think I caught.
The connection between violence against boys and men and violence against girls and women, whether or not you see that connection.
Okay. Yes, yeah, there's definitely a connection there. And and I do think that gender, that there's a social construct that dictates gender in a lot of ways. And, you know, again, we want to open that up, that masculine understanding. We want to open that up. We want to take the restrictions off, actually, undefine it, reimagine it.
Absolutely. Someone is asking about the first TED Talk you recommended. That was Tony Porter's TED Talk, A Call to Men, which does have, over 5 million hits. Sochi is asking, is any of your work in Spanish? Thank you so much for the work that you do.
Yes, excellent. Yes, so we have, so our curriculum, that Live Respect, Life Skills and Wellbeing for Boys and Young Men, we just translated to Spanish. So thank you for asking about that. And that can be found on our website as well. You can download the curriculum on the website. But if you want us to train you on it, then we would need to be in contact with you to talk about that. But it is free on the website if you just put your email in there. And many of our offerings are also in Spanish. We have training institutes for gender and racial justice that are done in Spanish, and we have some other offerings in Spanish. But the thing that's written that's in Spanish is the high school and middle school curriculum, Live Respect.
Wonderful. Okay, and one last question from Maggie. They say, thank you, Ted, and a call to men for leading this critical conversation. What are other ways nonprofits or corporations can support and uplift the key messages that you share? How can we all help make this change?
Yeah. Thank you. Well, if you can like us, you know, in our social media and just share what you've learned about it, share our website, really encourage folks to engage men and boys in their community. And we'd be, you know, a great organization to bring us out there to talk to folks. We do work in community. When we go into a community, we work with community leaders and assess what's needed in that community and then customize it specifically to that community or to that college campus. We do, when we go into a college campus, we like to go in and from their perspective on that campus. Then we engage men like through the athletic departments and Greek life and other areas and get male ambassadors to bring boy to bring young men and men on campus to have this critical conversation. So, just share the good news about the work of A Call to Men. It's really, we're really very proud of it, if you can't tell.
Yes.
and it's only because it's making a real difference. You know, it really is.
Well, you're absolutely making a difference, Ted. And thank you so much for your time and your wisdom and your brilliance and dedicating your life to this work. It really is making a difference. Thank you everyone for joining us. And if you have additional questions for Ted, because I see a few coming in, you've really inspired some conversation here, please email him directly at ted@acalltomen.org. Thank you, my friend. And any way we can support you, let us know.
Thank you. This is a big support. Thank you, Caroline.
Thank you so much. Take care, everyone.